Hello viewers, welcome to Experience Learning. How are you? Today we are going to discuss about primitive data types, then wrapper class, auto boxing, unboxing. These are very important in Java. So okay, I think you will be benefited from this because especially those who are IT experienced. Okay, let's start. Please subscribe to the channel. Though Java is an object-oriented programming language, still it supports primitive data types, not like other object-oriented programming language. Here I am not considering C++, but other programming language where everything is object. In case of Java, it is like that everything is object, still it supports for the calculation simplicity and all, that it supports the primitive data types. Now, what is data type? I think you are aware about it because from C and C++, that data type is a variable name. First, we have to discuss that what is variable. Variable which can hold some values, and it's allocating a memory address where it can hold the value. Say for example, here if I'm writing that in A, so here in memory location, say for example, the location address is A, it's 100,000, and 1000, the address 1000 is now to us, it is A. We don't know that what is the exact address of it, and if I am writing it's to 5, so this is a variable. Now, what kind of value a variable can hold? This can be decided from data types. Data type is to represent the variable in main memory. So, as you can see here, that Java has basically 8 primitive data types. What is this? Byte, short, int, long, char, boolean, float, double. Now, these data types can be broadly classified into 4 categories. From integer category, we are getting byte, short, int, long. And from character category, we are just getting only one character. From boolean category, so boolean is it's just taking the true or false. In character, you know that anything we can write it in a single quote. Now, float category. In float category, we are getting float and double. If we are writing that A equals to 5.05, this one is considered as double. But if we write it as 5.05F, then this one is considered as float. Or you can also typecast it in this way. Okay. If you are just writing float A, this one you will get an error because here it will be considered as double. Okay, remember this one. So here you can see that range of any data type is 2 to the power number of bits occupied by a data type. In case of byte, it's taking 1 byte. So it is actually totally it will be 2 to the power 8. 2 to the power 8 means 256. So if we count it from 0, so it will be 0 to 255. Okay. Now, for negative representation as well as a positive representation, if we divide it in 2 halves, we will get plus 127 to minus 128. Now you can have a question that why it is 127 and why it is 128, because here the 0 is considered as a positive number. That's why here we are getting 0 to 127. So the total number of positive is 128 and here we are getting minus 120. So minus 1 to minus 120. So it is from actually from 0 to from positive side 0 to 127 and from negative side it will be minus 1 to minus 128. Okay, now remember one thing, like other language, Java also used the 2's complement representation for the zero crossing. What is zero crossing? Zero crossing is in case of 1's complement, what happens? Let's check. I am taking 4-bit representation here. Okay, say I have number 0. 0 is positive representation in 4-bit 0000. Minus 0, this is positive 0, that's why we are getting 0000. And if it is negative 0, then we will get 1111. So the 0, we generally 0 is taken as a neutral, but in case of 1's complement, we are getting one value for zero, plus zeros and one values for minus zeros. But this problem is solved in if we are using the 2's complement representation. How? Plus it. We know that 1's complement plus 1 is 2's complement, so here we are getting 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. Here 1 will be discarded. So this is 0, 0, 0, 0. Isn't it? So, in case of 2's complement representation, we are able to get the positive 0 or negative 0, the same value, which is 0. So, for 0 crossing, generally like other languages, Java is also using 2's complement representation. Just remember it. And now, you can see here that others values are also given. Here for short, it's taking 2 byte and the range is given here. For int, it's 4 byte, range is given here. Long, you can see it. For float, the range is actually same as int. And for double, the range is same as long. Okay, it will be same. I'm giving the number 1, 2, 3, 4. So for 4, it will be 3, same like this. Okay. Now, if we are writing, say here I am writing int a equals to 2. 2 can be represented using 1 byte, isn't it? Fine. If I am writing short b equals to 2, or you can write it short 1. Fine. If we are writing a equals to b, is it possible? Yes, this is possible, and this one is known as implicit type conversion. You can see here for short it's taking 2 byte, for int it's taking 4 byte. So obviously a small box can be fit to a larger box. So here there will be an implicit type conversion and there you are not able to get any problem. But if the scenario is reverse, I mean though this is possible that to represent 2 in short, though is possible, but still from the compiler's points of view, just know that it's don't know. So if we are writing that b equals to a, though in this case this is possible, remember that it's possible to represent 2 as short, still you are not able to write this one. How can you write it? If you are giving the permission, yes, I am ready to lose any information. If there is any situation occurs that I have to lose some information, I am ready for this. So that time you have to write it short. If you are writing this, then you are allowed to write it. So from this one is known as explicit type conversion. Okay, the first one is implicit type conversion and the second one is explicit type conversion. So if you can see, check the size in byte. So from 4 to 2 explicit, 2 to 4 implicit. That means from int to short explicit, short to int implicit, float to double implicit, double to float explicit. Okay, so float to double implicit, double to float explicit. Hope you can understand. Now see the character category data types, char. So in case of C and C++, you know that it's taking one byte and it's only able to use the English language. It's use the ASCII format. And where in case of Java, it's taking 2 byte. Okay. Obviously, the range will be, you can understand, it's 2 to the power 8 and it stops. This one is already given, you can rewind this video. Here it's Java accepts 18 international language and the format is Unicode. Okay, Unicode is a format and the character set is 1 contains all the character. Here the Unicode contains all the characters which are available in 18 international languages. 18 international languages and it contains, how many character it contains? This one. You can note it down for any competitive exam purpose and all. So remember these things, that in case of Java, the character takes 2 bytes. Okay. As we know that in case of Java, everything is object. So an image can be considered as object, a file can be considered as object. Like this, a primitive data type can also be considered as an object. Now, I would like to say that this one is known as wrapper class. That means a primitive data type is wrapped and it provides the object of it, the object of primitive data types, and this one is known as wrapper class. Now the question is, why we need the object, I mean why do we need the wrapper classes? In case of Java, some data structures are already there and this is only available, it can only operate on object, not on the primitive data types. So if the data types are in primitive forms, we are not able to use that data structure and that inbuilt functions or methods which can only operate it on object. That's why it's necessary to convert or to use the object of these primitive data types. As we have 8 data types, we know that 8 wrapper class we have. Okay, let's check what are the wrapper class. So we have these wrapper classes and here it is data types and its corresponding wrapper class. Its corresponding wrapper class. You can see that it's very easy to remember because in case of data type, it's using the small, and in case of wrapper class, it's using the caps. You can also remember this in this way, that in case of Java, conventionally, the class name will always be started with capital. Okay. So as the wrapper class is class, so obviously here it will be started with capital letter, short. Here, just remember this one, int, and here it is integer. Rest of these are same name as it is in the data type, long, float, like this. So among this, I mean, 8 data types, this 4 data types are from number class. The number class is an abstract class. The number class is an abstract class, and byte, short, integer, long are extended from it. I think you know about inheritance. You can easily understand this. So here the byte, short, integer, long, this is extension of number class, where the number class is an abstract class, and rest of this is Boolean character. Now, also the float and double are from the number class. Six are from number class, where the number class is an abstract class, and these two classes, character and Boolean. So these are the data types and its corresponding wrapper class, and now we will see some important and very useful methods are already there. We know that the class concept is the name of the class, the attributes of the class, and the behavior of the class. Here you can consider the behavior, that means the methods, some useful methods are there with this wrapper class. Okay, now we will discuss about this useful methods. Not all is possible, but some important methods will be discussed. So here some important methods are written. One is isNan. isNan will tell, it will return true if the object is integer, otherwise it will return false. isInfinite, you can understand from this, if it is infinite then it will return true, otherwise it will return false. Now see about this one, the parse something, it may be parse byte, it may be parse int, whatever. So here it will take string as an argument and convert it its corresponding type. So if here we are using parse double, say I am writing parse double and something is parsed here, 44.4, right? Okay, whatever. Now the 44.8 will be converted to double type, and how it can be called? Double dot parse double. Here the parse is, parse something is a static type data. So if I am writing it public static, parse double something, the function is public static, something, and definition is there. So obviously when a method is static method, how can you call it? You have to call it using the class name. So here the class name is double dot parse double. If it is integer, integer dot parse int. Okay, in this way. So this is a very important and useful methods in wrapper class. Now we will see conventional boxing and unboxing, and then we will see the auto boxing and unboxing. Here we have int n equals to value, value is given 5 and n equals to 20. Now whenever you are writing integer object, this is object, integer is class, int one is object, and you are writing new integer n. Here the integer something, here the integer is the constructor of the class, the constructor of the class, and this one is known as Conventional boxing. If I am writing this integer into equals to 20, or you may write it integer into equals to m. You can write it also into equals to m. You can write it also. Here this one is known as auto boxing. So when it is boxing, when the primitive to wrapper class conversion, then this one is known as boxing. Here it is conventional boxing. You are calling the constructor and passing the value of it. This one is known as conventional boxing, and this one is known as auto boxing. Now unboxing is, you can understand that just the reverse. When it is taking the class type, that means object to its primitive data type conversion, then this one is known as unboxing. And here we are using int value method, it extracting the value of it. And here we can get for into is object dot the method you are calling the method. You know, in the previous video we have already discussed that how to call the method in class. You can also check it, that here the class and the object dot the method is called, and this one is known as conventional unboxing. And obviously this one int one is object, and you are converting it into primitive data type, which is p. Here the name of the variable is given as p, and this one is known as auto unboxing. You see this. So parse int is a very useful method. Parse something is a very useful method, taking the string as an argument and convert it corresponding type. And here what is boxing and what is unboxing, and what is auto boxing and what is auto unboxing. I guess you can understand about it. And one thing, say I am writing here a equals to 20 divided by I am giving here you may get k equals to 20 divided by 0, and here I am writing k1. Now tell me that if I am writing k1 dot is infinite, what will be the result? And if I am writing k1 dot is none, what will be the result? And here I am also writing, please remember this, write the answer in comment box. Here this one is for one question, and question number two I am giving you, say double f1 equals to infinite. Please write the answer in comment box. So 1, 2. Hope you enjoyed this video. Okay, thanks for watching. Subscribe the channel.